Hello students, let us start with the electrical properties of solids. Now solids show very wide range of electrical conductivity. We are talking about the metallic solids. So they are able to carry electricity. Now these solids, they are of three different types. One is conductors, others are insulators, and third is semiconductors. Now in case of conductors, the electrical conductivity, it is in the range of 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 7 ohms inverse meter inverse. In case of insulators, the electrical conductivity, it is in the range of 10 raised to minus 20 to 10 raised to minus 10 ohms inverse meter inverse. And in case of semiconductors, the electrical conductivity, it is in the range of 10 raised to minus 6 to 10 raised to 4 ohms inverse and meter inverse. Now, in case of these conductors, the examples can be quoted like this. For example, metals and electrolytes. So metals and electrolytes, those can be put under conductors. Okay. So electrolytes means ionic solids. So these are the ionic solids. In case of insulators, mostly they are non-metals or molecular solids. Non-metals or molecular solids. And semiconductors, conductors are mostly they are metalloids. Metalloids like silicon, germanium, and so on. Now this metal conducts the electricity by movement of electrons, and electrolytes, they conduct electricity by movement of ions here. So metal, it is conductivity is due to movement of electrons. Movement of electrons. And in case of electrolytes, they conduct electricity by movement of ions. Here. Now, this variation in the ability means conductors, they show electrical conductivity in this range, whereas insulator, they show electrical conductivity in this range, and semiconductors, they show electrical conductivity in this range. So, this variation in the ability to conduct electricity of metals, non-metals, metals, non-metals, and metalloids, it can be explained with the help of band theory. So we'll talk about the band theory. In case of band theory, this electrical conductivity due to conductors, insulators, and semiconductors, it can be explained. So it assumes that the atomic orbitals, in case of band theory, the atomic orbitals of atoms, obviously these are of atoms, in the crystal, they combine to form molecular orbitals. MOS means molecular orbitals. And these molecular orbitals, which are formed due to combination of atomic orbitals, they spread over the complete crystal structure. We have studied in the 11th standard about the molecular orbital theory. So, same number of atomic orbitals are combined to form same number of molecular orbitals. So, the number of molecular orbitals containing electrons greatly increases with increase in number of atoms participating in the crystal formation. Means you can put here the number of molecular orbitals. Number of molecular orbitals, those containing electrons, these are greatly increases with increasing number of atoms. As the number of atoms are more, there will be more number of molecular orbitals will be formed. A small plate of about 1 gram of metal may contain 10 raised to 20 electrons. 1 gram of metal, approximately it contains 10 raised to 20 electrons. Now, as the number of molecular orbital increases, the energy difference between the adjacent orbitals decreases. Means as there is the energy difference between the adjacent orbital, it goes on decreasing. Means the energy difference between the adjacent orbitals, between adjacent nearby orbitals, it will go on decreasing. So it decreases. Now the energy gap becomes very small. So energy gap, it becomes very small because there is a decrease in the energy of the adjacent orbital. As there is a decrease in the energy between the adjacent orbital, so this decrease in the energy decreases the energy gap between, it becomes very small, and energy gap between these orbitals, it becomes small. Here it becomes very small, and molecular discrete level means so what is this molecular discrete level merge into one another. They merge into one another to form a continuous band of molecular orbitals is formed. Now this bond extends over the entire length of the distance. So as the number of molecular orbitals increases, the energy difference between these adjacent orbitals, it decreases, and this decrease in the energy level in the molecular orbital, that decreases the energy gap between them. And the molecular discrete level, discrete means what? More individually separate or distinct level, they may merge into one another. Means all these energy levels, they merge into one another to form a band. Means you cannot locate differently all the molecular orbitals due to their decrease in the energies. Now each atomic orbital of the crystal correspond to one energy level in the band, which contains two electrons. Means each atomic orbital of the crystal, each atomic orbital in the crystal, it corresponds to one energy level. We have studied this in above principle, in one energy level in the band, because there is very less difference between this. So that very less difference, it results in the production of the band, means you cannot distinguish the each one of the energy level or the atomic orbital. So, and each of these, it contains two electrons. We know this because each atomic orbital, it contains two electrons. Now this, the energies in the higher energy level of a band, so I can write here energy in the higher energy level, in the higher energy level of a band, are, which are free, and they are mobile and responsible for electrical conductivity. So the energy of the higher energy level, means the atomic orbitals which are resulting in the formation of the molecular orbital, which are arranged with the increasing energies. So the molecular orbitals which are at the high energy level of a band, these are free to move. And due to this free or mobile nature of them, they are responsible for, these are responsible for electrical conductivity. These are responsible for electrical conductivity. Okay. So these electrons, they carry electrical conductivity due to this higher energy level. What are these actual and then higher energy level? These are nothing but the molecular orbitals. We have studied this molecular orbital theory in which we have seen that there are some bonding molecular orbitals with a lower energy level and antibonding molecular orbitals, they occupy higher energy level. Now this thing, same thing can be explained by giving the example of magnesium. For example, in case of magnesium, it has got atomic number equals to 12 and its electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6 and 3s2. So this 3s2, you can call this as the valence shell. This is the valence shell electron. Isn't it? So this is valence shell. Each magnesium atom has two valence electrons in 3s orbital. These are the two valence electrons in the 3s orbital. And 1 gram of magnesium strip, it contains 6.023 × 10^23, which is an Avogadro's number, divided by 24 equals to 2.5 × 10^22. This much number of atoms are present here. So when we, what is this 24? This is nothing but a molar mass of magnesium. So Avogadro's number divided by its molar mass, that will give you the number of atoms. So these are the closely packed atoms. Closely packed atoms. And 10^22 valence shells are there. So the interaction between these, now look at this, in case of 1 gram, this much number of valence shells are present, this much high number of valence shell is present here. Now, in case of this, I am talking about this, 2.5 × 10^22, closely packed atoms, means this much number of valence shell must be there, is that it? So the interaction between these orbitals, which orbital? This 3s2 or valence. We are talking about the valence orbital, that is 3s orbital. So this, the interaction between these orbitals, it leads to the formation of bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals. We have studied this in molecular orbital theory. We are comparing this band theory with the molecular orbital theory, remember. So the interaction between these orbitals or the valence orbitals or shells, it leads to the formation of bonding and antibonding molecular orbital. So it leads to the formation of bonding molecular orbitals and antibonding molecular orbitals. Okay. So these antibonding molecular orbitals, they are always having higher energy. And this bonding molecular orbital, they always have lower energy. So all molecular orbitals are very close to each other and cannot be distinguished from one another. So therefore, these orbitals are collectively called as a band. Means actually this band theory, it is nothing but a combination of these bonding molecular orbitals and antibonding molecular orbitals, because they are very close to one another and they, instead of showing them discrete, separate, they are just appear like a band. Okay. Now, the outermost filled energy band, so this is the filled one, this 3s orbital, this is the filled one. So the outermost filled energy band of filled 3s orbital are called valence band. Okay, so we are now coming to the very important, what is this valence bond and band and conduction band. So the outermost filled energy band. Now remember, always this valence band is a filled one. It may be partially filled, it may be completely filled. So the outermost filled energy band of filled 3s orbital. We are talking about this magnesium. So these are the valence shell and this is the orbital which is present. So this filled 3s orbital, these are called as the valence band. And the next empty band formed by the overlap of empty 3p orbital. So even though this 3s, in case of magnesium, 3s is filled one, but this 3p orbital, it is a vacant one. This is, all these energy levels are always available, even though they are not filled. So this 3, next to this 3s, there will be 3p. So this 3p vacant orbital is present here. So this empty 3p orbital in which electrons can move, means from the electrons from this 3s orbital, it can be moved to the vacant 3p orbital here. And this is called as a conduction band. So the conduction band is an empty one, remember. And the field band, that is a valence band. So this valence band is nothing but due to the this field 3s orbital or the valence orbital, remember. So this valence band has lower energy and conduction band has higher energy. Means bonding molecular orbitals, lower energy, antibonding molecular orbitals, higher energy. So this conduction band can be compared with antibonding molecular orbital and valence band can be compared with the bonding molecular orbital. Is that it? Now, the lower parts of the energy level are formed by the overlap of field 1s, 2s and 2p orbitals. So these 1s, 2s and 2p orbitals are also there. And these are having this, these 1s, 2s and 2p, these orbitals, they are having lower energy. So this valence band is comprises of 1s orbital, 2s orbital, 2p6 orbital and 3s also. So only this 3s orbital, the electrons from here can be jumped from this 3s to this 3p vacant orbital. Remember. So this is what it is shown here. You can see, look at this. This is the S band. S band means this is the valence, partially filled valence band actually. And this overlaps with the P band. P band means this is the 3p orbital actually. So there is an overlapping between these because there is a very less difference between the orbitals of these. And when they overlap, means the electrons from this S band, they can be jumped to this P band, and this jumping of electron is nothing but the carrying the electricity. So this happens with the conductors. This is the diagram for the conductor. There is very less difference between the valence band and the conduction band. The electrons can be easily jumped from valence band to the conduction band. Okay. So the metallic crystal, in metallic crystal, the valence bands and the conduction bands are very close to each other. And a very little energy is required for electrons to excite from valence band into the conduction band. So this field is the valence band and this is the conduction band actually. So in conduction band, electrons are delocalized. Delocalized means they are not at a fixed position and they are free to move from one end to the other end. So this can be moved from this end to this end. And this moving of electron, it results in the conduction of electricity. Is that it? Now in case of sodium atom, same you can explain with the sodium also. So in metallic sodium, if you take the example of metallic sodium here, the conduction band is partially filled and there is no band gap. Here, this is same with the magnesium also. There is no band gap. Is that it? So the same thing you can explain with the help of by taking the example of sodium also. Sodium, its atomic number is 11. So you can write here 1s2, 2s2, 2p6 and 3s1. So this, the electrons from here, these are comprising of the valence band. Okay. And the interaction of the partially filled 3s orbital, atomic orbitals of all the sodium atoms give rise to the same number of molecular orbitals. And all these are closely spaced molecular orbitals together form a continuous band of energies, which is called as a 3s band or the valence band. And lower half of the 3s band, so this is the lower half of the 3s band, it corresponds to the bonding molecular orbitals and it is filled, while the upper half of the 3s band, so this is the upper half of the 3s band, corresponds to the antibonding molecular orbital and this is empty. So there is no gap between these two halves. And the 3s band in the sodium, it is the conduction band which contains same number of electrons as the sodium atoms. So due to the very less difference between these two band, which two band? That is a conduction band and the valence band. These metals, they act as a conductor, means the electrons from here. The same thing is shown here. This is actually the S band overlapping with the P band. So this P band, this is nothing but a vacant atomic orbitals, which they combine to form molecular orbitals. So actually these are the antibonding molecular orbitals with the higher energies. So these electrons from here, they can jump from here to here and they carry electricity. Okay. Now this is about the conductors. Now what happens in case of insulators? Remember, now in case of insulators, the valence band is completely filled. So you can see here, this is the completely filled valence band and the conduction band is empty here. And the valence band and the conduction band in the insulator, so I'll write here, so valence band and conduction band and conduction band. So remember always, conduction band is empty. So the space is available for the electrons to move freely, or delocalized electrons are there. In the insulators, these are separated by a large energy gap. And you can see here, this is the large energy gap between the valence band and the conduction band. And this is called as the forbidden zone or large energy band. Okay. And the thermal energy do not promote. So how these electrons are jumping from, as I told in case of conductors, how this jumping of electron from this to this happen in case of conductors? By supplying thermal energy. So the thermal energy which promotes this electron from valence band to conduction bond, this is not sufficient. So at the result of conduction band, it remains vacant and material is not able to carry or conduct electricity. And that is why this such type of metal, non-metal, those are called as an insulator. Okay. Now, this is about the conductors and insulators. So in case if I review this, bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals, these are at the higher energy, these are at the lower energy. Valence band, they may be completely filled or partially filled. So here you can see this is a partially filled one. You can see here this S, and this overlaps with the empty conduction band. And as there is a very less difference, rather there is an overlapping of this valence and conduction band that results in the conduction of electricity. This is not happening in case of insulators due to the large difference between the valence band and the conduction band. And that is why insulators, they are not able to carry electricity. In the next lecture, we will talk about the semiconductor.